Thanks for joining us. I'm Laura McHugh. In January, 10 million people tuned into the season premiere of Downton Abbey. The Masterpiece series gives us a glimpse into the world of English aristocracy. Downton Abbey's writer and creator Julian Fellowes says one of the main characters was inspired by reading the book To Marry an English Lord. I had the chance to sit down with co-author Carol Wallace during her recent appearance in Bethlehem. The music draws millions into the glamorous and often dramatic world of Downton Abbey. The PBS series follows the Grantham family, led by Lord Grantham and his American wife, Lady Cora. The inspiration for Cora's character comes from the book To Marry an English Lord, co-authored by Carol Wallace. Historic Bethlehem Museums and Sites recently hosted Carol for a special appearance, and the writer made time to tell me about the real-life Coras featured in her book.
Cora is part of a historic phenomenon. In fact, there were about 300 American girls who married into the English aristocracy between about 1874 and 1914. And in fact, by the time World War I broke out, about 17% of the English aristocracy had some American blood.
Carol, you see a lot of love and tenderness between Lord Grantham and Lady Grantham displayed in the show and depicted in the show. How much of that happened in real life?
In a lot of cases, the men needed money, and the American girls had it. And the American girls, because they hadn't been socially successful in their own cities, found that they could be in England, and boy, that title was a big social boost. So in a way, it was a kind of almost a brokered arrangement where each party got something out of it, but love sort of came up last. Cora and Robert are very, very lucky that they got along as well as they did.
And I've heard you describe it before as they were there to produce an heir and a spare.
An heir and a spare, because of course the title goes to the oldest son, and if there is not a son, the title goes to a cousin or a nephew, and the money normally goes with the title, so you really have to produce boys. And you do see situations where a mother will have had one, two, three, four daughters and another daughter, and finally there's a son, and you think, oh, that poor woman. So Cora, I suppose she was lucky that she got to stop at three, but if you'll remember in season one, that was quite a plot issue. If she'd been able to produce a boy, then the whole thing with Matthew would not have come up.
You profile many, many women in your book, To Marry an English Lord. Which do you think most resembles Cora?
There is a woman named Mary Leiter, who to me is the model for Cora Grantham. And actually, I have had email correspondence with Julian Fellowes about this, and he says this is not the case. But there's so many similarities. Mary, like Cora, is from the Midwest and from a family whose money comes from retailing. And Mary's name is Leiter, Cora's name is Levinson. And it was also a situation where the marriage may have started as a kind of arranged marriage, but they came to love each other. Mary also had three daughters, just as Cora had the three daughters. So it seems like a pretty strong resemblance, and the timing is about right too. Also, she's really, really pretty if you see some of her pictures.
The dresses were just one of the perks that came with marrying into the aristocracy, but there were a lot of hardships that these women faced as well, weren't there?
There were considerable hardships, yes. I think a lot of the girls, for one thing, were not really country people, and the English aristocracy was very rurally based. So a girl might go to London, meet a man at a party, it would all be very exciting. She would marry him, and then he takes her off to the back of beyond, and there's nobody there. And she has all these beautiful dresses, as you say. She has no one to wear them for. There's nothing to do. So that's only the beginning of it. And then the servants are very hard to manage. They're not all like Carson and Mrs. Hughes. You know, they're not all pleasant. Sometimes they were very backbiting and very difficult. And then I think also Americans and British people do not communicate in the same way. That's true now, and I think it was just as true then. So there were a lot of hurdles that many of these girls had to overcome.
After a speaking engagement at the Moravian Museum, Carol took tea and signed books at the Kemmerer Museum of Decorative Arts, where I met the new curator of collections and exhibits, Caitlin Harvey. Caitlin, you're new to the museum in 2014.
I am. I've only actually been here for, I think, a month, but I'm very excited. The artifacts that we have here are amazing. Every day is like Christmas opening a new box and seeing these wonderful things. And we just opened my very first exhibit here called Colors that opened on Friday. And it actually speaks really well to Carol's lecture because so many of the artifacts are of that time period. So you can see dresses that ladies of wealth would have worn. My favorite dress is a 1920s orange velvet and tulle dress that was worn by Grace McMath, who's actually the wife of the vice president of Bethlehem Steel. So we actually have women that are similar to the people focused in Carol's book, and we have some of their artifacts here. People don't actually realize all of the artifacts that we have here and how vast it is. While we have wonderful dresses, there's fabulous ceramics and glass. We have a stunning paintings collection. So there really are a whole multitude of different objects here that I'm so excited to be able to use. And I'm really hoping that as we go forward, some of the exhibits that we have will reach out to a new demographic of visitors, because that's really what we want to do.
What do you have planned for your first year here?
We have a lot of exhibits that I can't talk about yet, but I know that they're definitely going to be edgy and modern and contemporary. And I think there's definitely going to be some interesting things happening at the Kemmerer, so you have to keep your eyes peeled as we move forward.
Much like Downton Abbey, To Marry an English Lord now appeals to a wider and younger audience 25 years after its original publication in 1989, a resurrection that has left Carol, to borrow the English phrase, positively gobsmashed.
In my absence, Cora.
Lady Grantham.
Cora.
Mama.
Very well done, Lady Grantham.
The newly renovated Kemmerer Museum is open Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays. Well, every summer, my first guest brings the Bard's stories to life on stage at the Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival, where Patrick Mulcahy is producing artistic director. Thanks for being on the show with us today.
Happy to be here.
This would have been the Bard's 450th birthday.
If only he had lived.
Well, his work certainly lives on, what do you have on tap this year?
Well, I'll start with the Shakespeare, since we began there. The Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival produces all sorts of types of plays, but we have a particular focus on Shakespeare and the classics. And the two Shakespeare plays this summer will be Shakespeare's The Two Gentlemen of Verona, which is an early play for him. He was probably in his 20s when he wrote it. And it's a lively romantic comedy that has a dog in it. There'll be a live dog on stage, so that's fun. And then Shakespeare's, swinging to the other end of the spectrum, Shakespeare's great classic tragedy, Macbeth. So those will be the two Shakespeare plays.
You operate two different theaters at DeSales University.
We do, right. The university is the host of this professional theater, the Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival, and we bring in artists from Broadway and film and television, and so in recent years the artists have included winners and nominees of Tonys and Emmys and Obie Awards, etc. So it's very high level work, and students, the best students in the university program, have a chance to be interns and get to, you know, practice the oldest form of actor training, which is watch this, you know, let's work together on this.
So what's going to be on the main stage versus in the smaller, more intimate Schubert Theater?
On the main stage, we will open this year with Fiddler on the Roof, an exquisite play, winner of 9 or 10 Tony Awards along the way. That'll open in June, on June 13th, and then the next play to open, there'll actually be two plays on the main stage in July that will operate in rep, Lend Me a Tenor, which is a contemporary comedy, a farce, and that will be in rep with Shakespeare's Macbeth. And what that means is that the same actors will be doing those two plays. They'll be in rehearsal for them at the same time, and then when they get to perform them, you could come on a Saturday afternoon and see Lend Me a Tenor, go to dinner, and come back in the evening and see the same actors in the same space, but on a completely different set, do Macbeth. So that's the excitement of doing plays in rep.
And you also operate Shakespeare for kids.
We do, yes. We had opportunities for high school students and middle school students to experience Shakespeare through our Willpower Tour that goes out to schools. The Linnie Fowler Willpower Tour goes out in the fall and reaches 15,000 students each year. But we didn't have anything that was specifically targeted for the elementary age group, and so we created something about 5 years ago called Shakespeare for Kids. It's an hour long. Whether the play it's focusing on is a comedy or a tragedy, it's a hoot for kids, and there are puppets, and it's an opportunity for them to just get a taste of this wonderful playwright's work.
Patrick, where can people go to learn more?
PAShakespeare.org is the best way. You can also call 610-282-WILL for our buddy Will Shakespeare.
Thank you so much for sharing this information.
Thank you.
Well, turning now from willpower to horsepower, Focus reporter Brittany Garzillo takes us to a Northampton County farm to learn more. Brittany? Thanks, Laura. If you ever rode a horse, you know that doing so can be quite therapeutic. A farm in Nazareth called Equi-librium uses therapeutic horsemanship to help those with special needs reach their full potential. Recently, I visited the stables to learn about hippotherapy, treatment with the help of a horse, and its benefits to both mind and body.
With every step of the horse, 30-year-old Renzo Viscardi from Bethlehem gets stronger.
He independently can now reach, grasp, open and close his fingers. His hands are still tight. He still does have high muscle tone, but he's over time able to do more and more in the area of fine motor control.
You figure out your strategies, maybe I can beat you.
In his house in Bethlehem, Renzo and his mother, Cheryl, play a game of tic-tac-toe. A small feat for some, but for Renzo and his family, it's a small miracle. At age 14, Renzo went into cardiac arrest and was diagnosed with an anoxic brain injury. Doctors said he would likely remain in a persistent vegetative state.
We are stubborn parents. I think parents in this situation, it brings up part of you you don't know is there, but you fight for your child's life and you assume hope.
After years of therapy and treatment, Renzo made improvements, but Cheryl says hippotherapy got Renzo back in the saddle and headed in a path of progress.
In Italy, a friend told us about, have you ever heard of hippotherapy? And we'd never heard of it, you know, and our job was just turn over every stone possible to improve. He couldn't sit up. He was basically laying back, you know, head ready to just rest on the rump of the horse. In 3 weeks' time, Renzo acquired a sitting balance. It was really amazing because he's riding tall and proud. And we didn't understand exactly why. I mean, why should that work better than anything else?
The difference is in the strategy that we're using. We use tons of different strategies as therapists to improve balance, muscle tone, strength, postural control, reflexes. But hippotherapy is a specialized use of equine movement.
At Equi-librium in Nazareth, dozens of children and adults with special needs, like Renzo, use this picturesque pasture as a therapy tool.
The horse provides movement that is forward and backward, side to side, and also rotational.
The three-dimensional movement of the horse aids in the development of the muscles, but it also provides an environment so that the children in particular are having physical and occupational therapy without realizing that it's therapy.
Polly Best co-founded Equi-librium in 2001. It began as an Easter Seals program called RISE, Riding Instruction for Special Equestrians. The organization recently relocated to a 19-acre farm in Nazareth and is home to 10 horses, including one miniature horse named Lil Bear.
It's not people feeling like I'm sick. I'll be sick the rest of my life. I need therapy the rest of my life. It's not about that, it's they love it.
Okay, Renzo, we'll start with your left leg.
For about an hour a week, over the course of 10 weeks, Renzo works one-on-one with occupational therapist Terry Ramsauer. Terry helps develop his motor skills with exercises, such as raising his hands and grasping reins. Renzo's friends and family say he's made substantial progress since he started therapy at Equi-librium in 2001.
You'll see us doing different things involving different directions of movement, changing speed, changing tempo. We can change the surface in order to change the neurological input that the participant is receiving. For instance, we might do a little warm-up in the indoor on the soft footing, which is shock absorbing. And then as his muscle tone comes down and relaxes a little bit, we'll do some things outside, probably on the paved driveway, which causes a different type of input into his nervous system.
It's here in the outdoor arena that Renzo's occupational therapist and two volunteers help guide Renzo and his horse Beauty around the track. Among many of the things that hippotherapy helps Renzo improve are things like muscle tone, strength, motor coordination, and balance.
We couldn't do it without the volunteers. For every rider, most of the riders, they can take up to three volunteers, one person at the head of the horse, leading if it's necessary, and one on either side.
It's really amazing. I think it's almost therapy to those who are here helping, whether it's a volunteer or you're an instructor, just being able to see the changes it makes, and because it's not just a physical impact on that person, it's a It's an emotional impact. It's a mental impact.
Today, Renzo lives in his own home, works a part-time job, and has attended classes at Northampton Community College. For the most part, he can eat and drink on his own, and even jam to his favorite tunes. All skills his mother attributes to horsepower.
For me, it all goes back to what was started with the horseback riding, that stimulated the neurological system and made everything else possible.
There were times where he just couldn't hold himself in the middle and keep himself centered. And he has grown, I think even as a person, he's grown socially. His smile just lights up the arena when he's in there.
A smile that Renzo's mother says took 4 months to get back now shines as bright as his road ahead. For Focus, I'm Brittany Garzillo reporting.
Thank you, Brittany. I'm now joined by Chris Dunnigan. Chris is the Senior Vice President of Human Resources at B. Braun Medical, and he's here to tell us about the Lehigh Valley Business Education Partnership. Thanks for being on the show.
Oh, thank you so much for having me on the show.
The Business Ed Partnership is new to many of our viewers. What is it and what are the goals?
Sure. The Biz Ed Partnership is a committee that's part of the Workforce Investment Board. And what we try to do is collaborate with education and industry and get educators and people in industry together and talk about what are the common issues, common problems, how do we make education better, because at the end of the day, most people go into careers and how do they get better careers.
So, Chris, there's already a partnership in place between B. Braun Medical and Catasauqua School District. How long has that been going on and what exactly happened?
Sure. It's been going on for 5 years, and the Superintendent Bob Spangler for Catasauqua School District is on the committee with me and others, and just in conversation talking about, can people from your company, Chris, come in and talk to our students about careers? So what we do then is we actually bring people in and from B. Braun Medical, and they have for 45 days, one semester, ninth graders go through a career awareness class, and we bring people in from B. Braun to do different and exciting things for them to introduce the students for careers.
And they actually follow the Lehigh Valley Career Pathways and focus on the four main areas you were telling me are arts and humanities, healthcare and human services, science and technology, and engineering. So students are being exposed to careers in all of those areas?
They are. And just an example for the arts and humanities, someone from my department, Human Resources, will go in, talk to them about careers, but we do a personality profile. Each student takes it, finds out what their personality type is like, and then what careers might match up with that.
I was gonna say, but you said it's more sophisticated than those old aptitude tests.
It certainly is, and we use what's called the People Code. It's the latest instrument, and the students take it, and what is their personality profile? So somebody who is very talkative, very easy in social settings, that person might be a good fit for sales. Somebody who's quiet, likes science and math, maybe they might end up being a scientist.
Chris, what does the future have in store for the Lehigh Valley Business Education Partnership?
What we're looking to do is to get other business leaders involved in the Lehigh Valley, the Business Education Partnership.
Thanks so much for sharing this information. Well, you can learn more at lvwib.org. For our next segment, Grover Silcox continues his series Roots with a trip to America on wheels. This Allentown Museum offers a trip down memory lane with cars, trucks, bicycles, motorcycles, horseless carriages, fine art, and even an old-fashioned diner. Here's Grover with more.
Thanks, Laura. The museum, built in 2008, features America's love affair with transportation and travel. It serves as the cornerstone of Allentown's redevelopment along the Lehigh River. Its exhibits rotate every 6 months and always feature something new. So buckle up and enjoy.
You'll discover America's passion for the road and roadside America at the America on Wheels Museum in Allentown.
When you look at this car, you would probably even like to drive something like this around today.
Volunteer Gary Peters shows us the 1963 Avante R2 by Studebaker, one of the cars in the museum's orphan exhibit, called Gone But Not Forgotten.
These are cars that have gone out of production from a major company like General Motors or Chrysler, or a company that completely failed due to economic conditions.
The Pontiac first rolled off the assembly line in 1926 and kept pace with America's most popular cars for decades. But the brand sputtered and died in 2010.
And this is a 1954 Pontiac convertible, one of the tops of the line for Pontiac back in those days. In fact, it even has the hood ornament that lights up.
The orphan exhibit also features the Chrysler DeSoto, the 1967 Amphicar car, which could transition from land to water, and the infamous 1959 Edsel, named after Henry Ford's son.
We have the original sticker here from the sale of the car, and in 1959, this car sold for $3,407.
After you check out all 17 orphans, it's off to the Education and Restoration Center, where you'll learn how to put a car back together.
We'll take a look at this 1934 Huttmobile, the way it was found in a barn. And if you would learn the skills and take the time and document taking this car apart, if you look across the room,
why, you'll learn how to restore the car
and turn it into a 1934 Huttmobile treasure.
In the South Gallery, you'll come to an old filling station and a wide variety of Mack trucks.
A lot of them are early 1900s, and their biggest colors were red and green, so it always looks like a holiday here in the Mack exhibit.
Kids, and even some big kids, can jump in a big rig and give it a whirl. And everywhere you look, there's the famous Mack Bulldog. The museum even holds an annual Bulldog Beauty Contest.
Place is packed when we have the Bulldog Beauty Contest.
The 45,000 square foot museum welcomes 35,000 visitors a year, plus folks who rent space for parties, get-togethers, and meetings. On this day, the Big Brothers and Big Sisters organization was holding a meeting here.
We have a room that we call the Alternate Fuel Room.
Gary finishes today's tour with what you might call a look back to the future.
We have cars dating back to 1895 that are total electric. Next car we're looking at is a 1922 Detroit Electric. This is a total electric car, had batteries in the trunk, batteries under the hood, had a range of 60 to 80 miles and a top speed of 40 to 45 miles an hour.
If you don't get a charge out of the old Detroit Electric, how about the Stanley Steamer?
The Stanley Steamers were very quick cars for their day. Actually, we have a Stanley Steamer from 1903 that in 1909 held the land speed record at 126 miles an hour. The biggest problem with the Stanley Steamers is it took you 45 minutes to build enough steam pressure for you and the wife to run to the store to get a loaf of bread and a quart of milk.
Speaking of milk, it's time to round out this road trip with a little roadside refreshment.
We have a 1950s Hubcap Cafe, which has made it possible for people to come and enjoy seeing a soda jerk behind the counter and having a fabulous milkshake and just listening to the jukebox and under the boardwalk and all the songs that just touch your heart and make you enjoy going back in time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That milkshake's just one more classic in a museum full of them. For Focus, I'm Grover Silcox reporting.
And he doesn't even bring milkshakes back for the rest of us.
I know. Well, you know, I'm really trying to bulk up. That's the only reason I drank it. That's one of the most enjoyable closings I've ever had, actually. It was delicious.
You should have brought some back for us.
I would have if I could have, but we'll all have to go to the museum and enjoy it ourselves in person.
And so, Brittany, for your story, I have a question that many of our viewers probably have. Why is it called hippotherapy if it's horses?
Well, I asked the same question, and what I was told was that hippo in Greek, it means horse.
So it's pretty interesting. It's you know, equine therapy, the equine movement. And I was also told that there's no one typical person that does hippotherapy at Equi-librium. You know, that's just one program that they offer, but it can be for children that are as small as 2 all the way up to people in their 70s.
Wow, that's amazing. And it seems like the appeal is that wide for Downton Abbey and for to marry an English lord. And in fact, Carol Wallace on her visit told me that normally at these events, she does not get a huge, huge turnout. Here she had 70 people in the middle of the week, in wow. the middle of the afternoon,
that's
and she completely sold through every book that she had with her, plus some,
wow.
took orders back, and you could not get your hands on a copy of To Marry an English Lord in Lehigh Valley this week.
Wow. That's fantastic.
Now, we do have something to tell our viewers at home. We have to say goodbye to our director, Tyler Glenn. Tyler has been at PBS 39 for many years. I don't want to date him, but it's been at least 14 or 15 years that he's been a member of the station. He will be so missed, and he is such a big part of our team here.
He really is.
We'll miss you, Tyler.
Miss you, Tyler. Bye. Well, that wraps up not just our show, but our season of Focus. Viewers at home, thank you so much for tuning in and spending your Friday evenings with us. We covered over this year, covered more than 100 area businesses and organizations, put together 125 segments, and we're so grateful to those of you who tuned in and made the journey with us.
And we had a lot of fun doing it, too.
We really did. And we ended it with a milkshake.
So thank you for joining us, and remember to focus on what matters.